by not only the full fulfillment of Scripture, but the fact that that Scripture has been fulfilled today in the person of Jesus, as Jesus stands or sits in the synagogue to tell the people, I am here. It kind of gets back to the lesson of the last hour. He is proclaiming to the people in his hometown that he is the fulfillment of this passage from Isaiah. Understand how important that is. I would almost use the word except for the fact that it's Jesus who you're talking. I would almost use the word brazen. It's almost a brazen claim. But it's not a brazen claim. Why? Because it's true, exactly. I am him. Now, just by comparison, this is not off the subject of the dictionary, go back to John 4. There was something in there I wanted to cover and didn't because I didn't think we had time. So let me cover it now. Let's get it in. I think it's that important. You know that a number of times in the Gospel of John, especially, Jesus will refer to himself as I am. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way of the truth and the life. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. It goes on and on and on. Many Bible students who study this very seriously believe that Jesus is making a conscious connection, between what is said here by him and what is said by God to Moses back in Exodus 3. There's that burning bush. Moses goes over there and sees what's going on. All of a sudden, God's talking to him. God says, I've got a job for you. Moses says, I don't want it. But God says, you're going to take it anyway. And you're going to go over there and lead the people out of bondage. Huh? When I go over there and make such a claim as that, who am I going to say sent me? Well, God says, you tell them, I am. I am the sent you. Because he goes on to say, I am who I am. Now, a number of times, like I just said, Jesus would use that statement. Now, look at John chapter 4, verse 26, and play like the words, who speak to you. Play like, remember when you did that as a child? Play like they're not there. The word he is italicized, meaning it's not there. What do you got left? He is making a claim to his eternal nature and to his eternal existence. Somebody asked me on the way out this morning, did you say that Jesus is eternal? Yes. Absolutely. The Godhead in the beginning, the Godhead created the heavens and the earth. All you have to do, and I know you've done this before, so you know what I'm talking about. All you have to do is study and read the first 17 verses of John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word and so on. That's definitely talking about the eternal nature of Christ. Okay, let's stop there. Father, we thank you all today for all your goodness. We ask you to be with us and use us in your service and your glory. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. Okay, so then, he goes on to say what he says in the sermon, if you will, that begins in verse 23 and runs down through verse 27. I'm not going to read that since we read it last week. You see it there before you for your own reading. But anyway, look at verse 28. So all those in the synagogue who had heard these things were filled with wrath. Now notice if you go back to verse 22, so all bore witness to him and marveled at the what kind of words? The gracious words. Oh, that's nice. That's very good. That's very gracious. We have to go in the back. The gracious words which proceed out of his mouth. But somebody says, well, now wait a minute. Is not this Joseph the carpenter's son? Where did he get such a deal as this? Where did he get the ability to do all of this? And so Jesus says, you're going to say to me before it's over, physician, heal yourself whatever you're doing in your country, either here in your own country. And Jesus will say, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. Or as you read last week, no prophet is accepted in his own hometown. I don't like that. No prophet is accepted in his own hometown. Okay? So, what's happening? They have turned from talking about gracious words, what about their sermon, to this point now, they're about to try to kill it. Have you ever seen a more dramatic change than this? What's what happens? What happened? Got Elijah, okay, here we go, verse 28. So all those in the synagogue when they heard these things were filled with wrath. They rose up, they rushed him out of the city, they headed to the brow of the hill on which the city was built that they might order that, they might throw him down over the cliff. I was watching something here, editorial comment. On the one hand, television is so absolutely fascinating, but there is nothing on it to watch. And just out of interest, I sometimes stop when I channel something, which I do all the time. I sometimes stop at the world of the religious, what I call the religious channels. And I was watching a documentary on one of the religious channels that I attempted broadcasting that word. And this guy was doing a tour, and he had taken his viewing audience into that modern-day Nazareth. And he had gone to what they think may have been the very hill on which these people took Jesus to throw him down in the pit. If that is the right place, I don't know if you let him know, but if that is the right place, from up here where he was when they got ready to throw him down to here, pretty good piece. And I'm sure there were lots of rocks and things down here, so the chances are that they could have killed him were very good, very strong. Okay, so here you go now. Then passing through the midst of him, he went his way. Now, we don't know exactly why they didn't try to stop him. Were they then awed by his presence? Were they at all by his power? Were they fear stricken? Doesn't say. But what it does say is that Jesus just walks right through them and leaves and nobody cares about the Son. Alright. Now we're down to where we're going to be today. Then he went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and was teaching them on the Sabbaths, probably in the synagogues. Capernaum in Jesus' day was a fairly large-sized city. It was a prominent area on the northeast shore, or is it the northwest shore, of the city of Galilee. And it had begun primarily as a fishing village, but had become more than that by Jesus' day. It had become, in fact, probably somewhat a center of business, buying, selling fish, whatever else they did. So Jesus, now go back to Matthew, it's chapter 4, I forget the verse. Matthew says early on in his public ministry, Jesus left Nazareth. He would not live there any longer. That would not be his town of residence. He would move to Capernaum. As much as he ever had a permanent home, that permanent home became Capernaum. Now remember that statement that Jesus made in one place I thought about a whole lot through the years. Remember what he said, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, the sun ran up in that place to lay his head. Remember that? You know that in the Bible? Yeah. I'm over here on a meeting now. And at that time, during my chapel circle, I come across the old city and some of those other guys. Oh, man. Notice the word we, which is not in the text, as far as I can tell. It's so amazing. This is a demon speaking through a man. Remember what James said in chapter 2? Even the demons believe in one of them. They fear or tremble. Right, exactly. Okay. Whatever you do with him, the first thing he calls him is Jesus of Nazareth. That was common. I'm Dan of Humboldt. That's where I'm from. They did not last in days. They sometimes refer to a person as the son of God, this person, that person, or somebody else. But sometimes they just identify a person by the name of his name. Did you come to destroy us? The answer is yes. I know who you are, the son says. You are the Holy One of God. Now look at you, God. It's kind of like some of this other material we talked about last time. You are Jesus, Savior or Deliverer from Nazareth. But you are also the Holy One separated, set apart of or from God. 1 Timothy 3 is verse 15. The mystery of godliness, God was manifested in the flesh. In his flesh. Okay. So, verse 35. Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." This is parallel to some other things. Remember the sword on the sea? And how the disciples just go in and then how the boats come up around and they're all on the ground and where's Jesus? He's in the back end of the boat hanging out. And they can't stand that, so they wake him up. You're going to let us drown? We're not good at it? And Jesus simply has to say, as he says here, "Be quiet." Or as more commonly, and it even sings, "Be still." Those who know the language very, very well, as an included me, say that it would be very appropriate to say that what Jesus is saying here is, "Be muzzled. Put a muzzle on it." When you think of a muzzle, what do you mean to think of? Your dog. Yeah. Your dog, or better yet, it's the neighbor's dog. And he wants the neighbor to put a muzzle on his dog so it won't bark at you away at night. Right. Be muzzled. Be quiet. Be still. Whichever term you choose to use there, notice that it all goes back to the matter we looked at above in verse 32. He did what he did with authority. It's not just that he talked with authority, but that's not what he says. But he commanded the unclean spirits with authority as well. We're really getting into the gist now of what Luke's all about. We've had all of this material. We've just remembered this. We've met Zacharias and Elizabeth. John the Baptist has been born. We've met Mary. Jesus has been born. There's been the purification ceremony. There's been the presence of the temple. There's been the flight to Egypt, which Luke doesn't mention. There's been the return to Nazareth. And 12, there's been the going to the temple to take Jesus maybe for the first time. And he increases in the wisdom, stature, and so on. Then he's baptized by John the Baptist. Now he's about 30 years of age. In the genealogy last week, about 30 years of age. And he's in his public ministry. We are in something called by the scholars the period of the Galilean ministry. We will stay in this, I believe, until the end of chapter 9. Chapter 10, verse 1, let us say. Well, anyway, Jesus at some point sets his face to go toward Jerusalem. Okay, where he's going to die. Okay, and when the demon had thrown him in their midst, it came out of him and did did not hurt him, but they were all amazed, and they spoke among themselves what a word this is. And watch what's called. For with authority and power, he commands the unclean spirits that they come out. And the report about it went out of every place in the surrounding region. Now, here's what I want to say. There is a difference between authority and power. There are two different words in English. There are two different words in Greek. Authority is one thing, power is another. Let us make this distinction. Power is the ability to do something, whatever it is. The ability to do something. Authority is the right to do that thing. Power is the ability to do something. By that, I don't think it's serious. Authority is the right to exercise that power or ability to do what Jesus wants to do. And whatever Jesus wants to do is consistent with the will of God. I'm in the bag. There they go. Okay. Let's stop this doing this. I think we will see this in the text of the U.S. podcast on what I'm going to say right now. I think this became a real question for me when I was teaching Bible in 3 hours ago. I don't know why, I had some of the kids say to me, what's the difference here? I gave it some kind of attention. But one day, that's the time when I actually was fighting with the element. When you talk to your heart, when you got at least 3 hours. And I decided I'd go to the student library in the office of the building right next door. And the library started doing some research on the human laws, the study of English. I went through the car catalog. I got started running the used car catalog. James, is that right? Don't use car catalog. No, me, no. Okay, all right. Well, I'm an antique machine, I know. I'm an old shoe, very, very old shoe. So I went over to the car catalog and found all the stuff they can find through the years about demons. I found one book in a university library. Now, there might have been articles and encyclopedias and all that, journals and all that stuff. But there just wasn't much material there. Here's what I understand doing studies from other places. Here's what I understand demon to be. It is something, or if you want to say someone, it is something or someone sent by Satan to do everything within its power, as power was given to it by Satan, to thwart, even to destroy the work that God was doing through Jesus Christ. The problem was the demons couldn't do it. Every time there is a confrontation between Jesus and the demons, Jesus always wins for all of the world. He always wins, right? So, demons are sent by Satan to combat, hopefully in his case, the work of God through Jesus, and they fail. Now, I'm going to tell you something now, and somebody's going to say, where is this in the Bible? And I'm going to tell you anything else. It's not in there. Let me get started here a minute, okay? I look back now at the age of 80. And I think about all the people who testified. My parents, sure. School teachers, elders in the church, preachers, sure. But I mean, when I got older and it was beginning to find my way, I will never get over the impact it made on my life. My first and foremost, I swear to God, I will never. I still sit on the side of my bed sometimes in the quietness of the night and realize something else you did for me that I didn't want to do. What a promise. For the fine sheen of the hands on the face of Christ, that he was the pain of the joy. I not only went to school, but I worked hard, and it was just hard for 2 years. I never had a shrink, even in a shrink. Then I went back to a Christian. And I wondered what I was doing at that somewhere along with mommy and daddy. And they took me in like I was somebody important. And a 2-year-old freshman, I realized I was paying my own way. Not only my tuition, but I went to motor gas in my car, and everything else went to the apartment, the one compartment I lived in, and I was making a profit of over $200. But I made me money. us. Very selfish. But especially if I'm a bit expensive, then play it back. Exert one of the finest and best scholars of any speaking world. If we don't take all that like this, then it's a secret context of what I'm about to say. If Pat said something was a certain way, whole day in prayer was all in it, right? And I remember the same thing in talking about demons one day in a class called New Testament about chapter 1. And he said his understanding was that the demons by and large, not necessarily all together, by and large, were sent to this earth by Satan at the same time that God sent his son. With the idea that the demons could destroy Jesus. And the very reverse happened, Jesus destroyed the demons. But after that, reference to demons, by and large, over a period of time, reference to demons disappears from scripture or from church history. There has been a resurgence in demonology in our time. Right? You know who Charles Stonewall is? Okay. Heard Stonewall say one day in a sermon that if you don't believe there are demons today, you're still Africa. Now, there are sicknesses in Africa. But I don't believe there are demons. So if Pat was right, the same reason that, then demons were. It's kind of like special forces. Okay? Satan sends his special forces, the most highly trained, skilled soldiers he's got to earth to combat Jesus. The problem is that one of their enemies is the Son of God. And they should have known when they were getting there, but they didn't know when. Satan was giving it his best or worst, whichever. Okay. And that's the end of the other ways. But it's an important subject. But don't make too much out of it. I talked with someone not too long ago who was concerned about the loved one. This person I'm in the church. And they wondered if maybe his loved one was demon possessed. In the context of the discussion, we didn't have much time to talk about that, but they brought up that point. Is this person demon possessed? And my father and I had to know where that was not the time to talk. Okay, I'll put that back in the chair. So, anyway. Diagnosis this as a high and rebuked the fever, and he left her. Now watch this next word, not a second word. And immediately she arose and served. I don't know where it was, but I remember I was studying the Gospel of Mark. And it dawned on me, as it never had before, Mark loved the word immediately. It's immediately this, immediately that, immediately something else, and immediately this, and so on. And it's a good word. And why is it a good word right here? Why is it a good word anywhere to say that Jesus did something and immediately something happened? Why is it important?
Power.
What?
Power.
Because the Bible says it?
No, the power that Jesus
had. Oh, okay. That's right. See, that's Jesus. Yeah, all right. Now, this is not, okay, I'm going to lay my hands on her for a second here. But I'm going to rebuke the fever. 6 months she'd be well. Never. What's it say? What's happened? I said, something like a miracle has taken place. Immediately. She's up. She not only up, but what's she doing?
She starts serving.
She's cooking supper. Okay. You see, it's also, I don't know if this word is significant, I would not be able to work, but it is almost seemingly insignificant. So what? She got up and she cooked supper. Big deal, so what? A few minutes ago, she had a high fever when they did the bed, she's about to die. Now, me. She's up and she's serving. Okay. Anyway. There it is. All right, and we're not that big hurry. Let me see what it is. Look, my Bible probably lines has an indivision over each situation. Beginning in verse 40, immediately he went back to the Sabbath sunset. Verse 42, Jesus preaches in Galilee. Then we get through to chapter 4, verse 3 again. When the sun was set, all those who had been that were sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. Now in verse 41, separate category. And demons ran. And demons also came out of them, crying out and saying, as they did, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God. And Jesus rebuked the demons, did not allow them to speak because they knew that he was the Christ. And he wasn't quite ready for a universal broadcasting of that fact at this point. Okay. But look back at verse 40. The Son is sent. So? What's the good thing about that? What in the world would Luke bother to tell us the sun going back? Sun goes back every day. Come on. Stay with me. I'm going to do that. No matter what you do, what that means is not. Mark, we know what you're going to say. Because we're talking about what happened on the Sabbath and the synagogue in the Galilee. Now here we are, and he's teaching them on the Sabbaths, plural, that's verse 31. Now he leaves the synagogue, he goes to Peter's house, and takes care of Peter's mother-in-law. And by the time all that gets done, the sun is setting, the sun is going down. What time of day is it? It's evening. What time on the clock is it in the average? Six. What happened to 6 o'clock? The law of Moses said that on Sabbath he could not do anything that constituted a burden. The problem that the Jews got into was being able to divide it on a burden. If I take a sick person and bring him to you and carry him at a distance, I am violating the law of Moses. It got so bad that if you were a tailor and you had a straight pin and you put it in your shirt or whatever and left it there and it was there on the Sabbath, that straight pin was a burden and you violated the law of Moses. I like this dictionary. See, if you didn't want to say that, it's very nice because it's scary. It is.
Okay, we got it good.
Somebody mark. What's your mark verse 40? 40. Okay. And I'll try.